Well, good morning. The Senate Armed Services Committee meets this morning to receive testimony on the global threats faced by the United States and our allies as part of our oversight of the President's defense budget request for fiscal year 2017. I'd like to welcome back Director of National Intelligence James Clapper and the Director of the Defense Intelligence Agency, General Vincent Stewart. As this is likely his final appearance before this committee at our annual Worldwide Threats hearing, I'd like to thank Director Clapper for over five decades of service to protecting our country. Director Clapper, in particular, we thank you for leading the men and women who strive every day to collect and analyze the information that helps keep America strong. I thank you for being with us today, and I've had the honor of knowing you for a long time, and I know of no individual who has served this nation with more distinction and honor, and we're grateful for your service, and we know that that service will continue in the years to come. The list of the threats confronting our nation is drearily familiar, yet it is impossible to say we have seen much improvement. In Afghanistan, 9,800 American troops are still in harm's way. The Taliban, Al-Qaeda, and the Haqqani network continue to threaten our interests in Afghanistan and beyond, and now ISIL has arrived on the battlefield, raising the specter of yet another ISIL safe to plan and execute attacks. Regional order in the Middle East is breaking down, and this power vacuum is being filled by the most extreme and anti-American of forces, Sunni terrorist groups such as ISIL and Al-Qaeda, Shiite extremists such as the Islamic Republic of Iran and its proxies, and the imperial ambitions of Vladimir Putin. ISIL has consolidated control over key territories in Syria and Iraq. It is metastasizing around the region and expanding globally from Afghanistan, as I said, as well as to Lebanon, Yemen, Egypt, and most worryingly, to Libya. It has also conducted or inspired attacks from Beirut to Istanbul, Paris to San Bernardino. More than a year into our military campaign against ISIL, it's impossible to say ISIL is losing and we are winning. At the same time, Iran continues to challenge regional order in the Middle East by developing a ballistic missile capability, supporting terrorism, training and arming pro-Iranian militant groups, and engaging in other malign activities in places such as Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Gaza, Bahrain, and Yemen. As the Islamic Republic receives tens of billions of dollars in sanctions relief from the nuclear deal, it's obvious that these activities will only increase. Russia annexed Crimea and continues to destabilize Ukraine with troubling implications for security in Europe. And Putin's intervention in Syria has undermined negotiations to end the conflict by convincing Assad and his allies they can win. In Asia, North Korea continues to develop its nuclear arsenal and ever more capable ballistic missiles, one of which it tested this weekend in violation of multiple UN Security Council resolutions. China continues its rapid military modernization while taking coercive actions to assert expansive territorial claims. At the time of this hearing last year, China had reclaimed a total of 400 acres in the Spratly Islands. Today, that figure is a staggering 3,200 acres with extensive infrastructure construction underway or already complete. I look forward to our witnesses' assessment of the nature and scope of these challenges and how the intelligence community prioritizes and approaches the diverse and complex threats we face. As policymakers, we look to the intelligence community to provide timely and accurate information about the nature of the threats we face and the intentions of our adversaries. We have high expectations of our intelligence community, as we should, and as they do of themselves. However, we cannot afford to believe that our intelligence agencies are omniscient and omnipresent, especially after years of sequestration and arbitrary budget caps that have damaged our nation's intelligence every bit as much as they have the rest of our national defense. Unfortunately, this misperception is only fed by the prideful assertions of politicians seeking to justify their policies. For example, during the Iran deal, we were told that the United States has, quote, absolute knowledge about Iran's nuclear military activities. We are told that the deal, quote, absolutely guarantees that we will know if Iran cheats and pursues a nuclear option. This hubris is dangerously misleading and compromises the integrity of our debate over important questions of U.S. national security policy. Americans must know that intelligence is not like in the movies. Although our intelligence professionals are the best in the world, there will not always be a satellite in position or a drone overhead, and not every terrorist phone call will be intercepted, whether it is Russian military activities on the border of NATO, or the movement of terrorist groups across the world, or of any of the other number of hard targets that we expect our intelligence community to penetrate and understand. We will not always know how our adversaries make decisions, let alone understand their implications. This is doubly true if we further constrain our nation's intelligence professionals through policy decisions that limit their effectiveness. Our intelligence capacity and capability are just like anything else, constrained by the limitations of time, space, technology, resources, and policy. As one senior U.S. official acknowledged about limited understanding of ISIL 2 years ago, quote, "A lot of the intelligence collection that we were receiving diminished significantly following the U.S. withdrawal in Iraq in 2011, when we lost some of the boots-on-the-ground view of what was going on." Put simply, if our national leaders decide not to be present in places, we should not be surprised later when we lack sufficient intelligence about the threats and dangers that are emerging there. As we receive this important intelligence update today, we must remember that it is the responsibility of policymakers from the White House to the Pentagon to here on Capitol Hill to invest in cutting-edge capabilities that can provide early indication and warning, as well as to provide our intelligence professionals with sound policy decisions and support, including at times military support that enable them to perform their often dangerous and always important work on behalf of our nation. If we fail to make these commitments, we will continue to be surprised by events at an ever-increasing cost to our national security. Senator Reid.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and let me join you in welcoming the Director of National Intelligence, General Clapper, and Director of Defense Intelligence Agency, General Stewart. Your long service, both of you gentlemen, to the nation is deserving of praise. I particularly want to echo the Chairman's comments, General Clapper, about your distinguished service and your continued service, I'm sure. Thank you, gentlemen. We live at a time when there is a complex array of threats facing the United States, some immediate, some in the future. It is a challenge for both the administration and Congress to decide how to allocate our nation's finite resources to address those threats. Your testimony today will provide needed insight for our committee on that challenge. In Afghanistan, for example, the security and political environments both remain challenging. The Taliban have sought to take advantage of the still maturing Afghan security forces by increasing their operational tempo, especially in rural areas. Also, an ISIL affiliate has entered the battlefield in the form of the so-called Islamic State in the Khorasan province, or ISKP. All the while, remnants of al-Qaeda continue to seek a resurgence. Pakistani army operations across the border have added to the dynamic by pushing other bad actors, including the Pakistan Taliban and Haqqani Network, into Afghanistan. I look forward to the assessment of our witnesses of these security challenges for the coming year and the prospects for reconciliation between the Afghan government and the Taliban. While ISIL controls less territory in Iraq and Syria than it did a year ago, it remains a significant threat to regional stability, the United States, and our allies. As our efforts to support the Iraqi security forces and local forces in Syria continue, there are a number of questions we must ask. What local forces will serve as a whole force once ISIL is removed from Mosul, Raqqa, and the surrounding areas? How will Iran seek to advance its interest in Iraq? How will Turkey respond to the threat posed by ISIL within its borders? Will our partners across the Gulf unify their efforts in Syria? And how will ISIL react within Iraq and Syria and transregionally as it is put under increasing amounts of pressure? These are questions our military forces must factor into their planning efforts in order to ensure the success of our campaign. Again, I look forward to your assessments on these important issues. The past year has seen substantial changes in the nature of the international community's relationship with Iran. The Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action between the so-called P5 plus 1 and Iran has halted and rolled back dangerous elements of Iran's nuclear program and, critically, has placed it under the most comprehensive and rigorous verification regime ever assembled. But I hope our witnesses will provide their assessment of the likelihood of Iran complying with this agreement over its term. While the JCPOA made substantial progress with respect to Iran's nuclear program, it also enabled Iran to return to the international economic community. This presents the United States and our partners in the Middle East with an adversary with additional resources they may use to support its proxies in places like Syria, Lebanon, Yemen, and other locations in the Gulf. Iran may also choose to use these additional resources to advance its missile program. Iran's decisions in these respects will be a key metric as we evaluate how to array our forces across the Gulf and what assistance our partners across the region will require to confront Iran. I would welcome our witnesses' assessment of the Gulf nation's current capacity to counter Iran's proxies and unconventional forces, and where this committee should consider additional investments to better support our partners' requirements. Russia's posturing and increasingly aggressive acts in Eastern Europe and in the Middle East are something we must continue to monitor, contain, and when necessary, counter. The President's decision to increase funding for the European Reassurance Initiative is a critical step. We must keep a watchful eye on the Putin regime, particularly its use of conventional and unconventional tactics to bully its neighbors and others. Russia's Syrian campaign has for the moment eclipsed its aggression in the Crimea and Ukraine as the most serious flashpoint in U.S.-Russian relations. In Syria, Russia continues to bolster the military of the Bashar al-Assad regime, while simultaneously running an information operations campaign to suggest that its military operations are instead focused against the Islamic State. Unlike Russia's obscured hand in Ukraine, its actions in Syria are being played out in daily headlines that report on Russia's indiscriminate bombing and its support of the Syrian regime in areas where moderate forces are aiming to get out from under the rule of the Assad regime. This is a complex problem for the United States, the coalition fighting ISIL, and our friends and allies in the region. I look forward to hearing how the intelligence community sees this situation and how the United States can best protect and advance our interests. North Korea presents an immediate and present danger to global security. The regime conducted a rocket launch just a few days ago in violation of multiple UN Security Council resolutions following its January nuclear test. While China could exert pressure on North Korea through economic sanctions to encourage the regime to desist, the Xi administration prefers to remain on good terms with the North Korean regime, putting the entire region at risk. Without China's cooperation, it is clear that North Korea will continue to develop its nuclear and ballistic missile capabilities. China continues to invest aggressively itself in its military, particularly in capabilities that allow China to project power and deny access to others. While China's economy has experienced the most significant challenges in recent memory, China is continuing its aggressive efforts to solidify its claims in the South China Sea, despite the protest of its sovereign neighbors. It is critical that we enhance our partnerships with others across the region to bring China into the rule of law based on a global regime that will guarantee peace and prosperity across the region. It's also critical that we use all of the nation's tools to ensure that China's continued theft of our intellectual property is put to a halt. I look forward to your views regarding China's adherence to President Xi's pledge to President Obama to cease such economic espionage. An area of equal concern is the threats and opportunities presented by cyberspace. From a military standpoint, our forces remain dependent on our ability to collect intelligence, conduct defensive cyber operations to protect our networks and also our intellectual property, and as appropriate to counter with offensive cyber operations, including actions against certain adversaries who utilize the Internet for recruitment, propaganda, and command and control. And we look forward to our witnesses' assessment of these approaches. Again, let me thank you, gentlemen, for your service, and I look forward to your testimony.
Director Clapper.
Chairman McCain, Ranking Member Reed, and distinguished members of the committee, first, thank you both for your acknowledgement of my service. It was last week marked 55 years since I enlisted in the Marine Corps Reserve. Very proud of that. Proud to be sitting next to one.
An inauspicious beginning.
I also, Chairman McCain, would want to thank you for your acknowledgement of the great men and women who work in the intelligence community for both of us. And I also appreciate your, very accurate statement about the capabilities of the intelligence community, what we can and can't do, and what it is reasonable to expect and not to expect us to do. I appreciate that. General Stewart and I are here today to update you on some, but certainly not all, of the pressing intelligence and national security issues facing our nation. And after listening to both of your statements, I think you're going to hear some echoes here. So in the interest of time and to get to your questions, we'll just cover some of the wave tops. As I said last year, unpredictable instability has become the new normal, and this trend will continue for the foreseeable future. Violent extremists are operationally active in about 40 countries. 7 countries are experiencing a collapse of central government authority. 14 others face regime-threatening or violent instability or both. Another 59 countries face a significant risk of instability through 2016. The record level of migrants, more than 1 million, arriving in Europe is likely to grow further this year. Migration and displacement will strain countries in Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Americas. There are now some 60 million people who are considered displaced globally. Extreme weather, climate change, environmental degradation, rising demand for food and water, poor policy decisions, and inadequate infrastructure will magnify this instability. Infectious diseases and vulnerabilities in the global supply chain for medical countermeasures will continue to pose threats. For example, the Zika virus, first detected in the Western Hemisphere in 2014, has reached the U.S. and is projected to cause up to 4 million cases in this hemisphere. With that preface, I want to briefly comment on both technology and cyber. Technological innovation during the next few years will have an even more significant impact on our way of life. This innovation is central to our economic prosperity, but it will bring new security vulnerabilities. The Internet of Things will connect tens of billions of new physical devices that could be exploited. Artificial intelligence will enable computers to make autonomous decisions about data and physical systems and potentially disrupt labor markets. Russia and China continue to have the most sophisticated cyber programs. China continues cyber espionage against the United States. Whether China's commitment of last September moderates its economic espionage remains to be seen. Iran and North Korea continue to conduct cyber espionage as they enhance their attack capabilities. Non-state actors also pose cyber threats. ISIL has used cyber to its great advantage, not only for recruitment and propaganda, but also to hack and release sensitive information about U.S. military personnel. As a non-state actor, ISIL displays unprecedented online proficiency. Cyber criminals remain the most pervasive cyber threat to the U.S. financial sector. They use cyber to conduct theft, extortion, and other criminal activities. Turning to terrorism, there are now more Sunni violent extremist groups, members, and safe havens than at any time in history. The rate of foreign fighters traveling to the conflict zones in Syria and Iraq in the past few years is without precedent. At least 38,200 foreign fighters, including at least 6,900 from Western countries, have traveled to Syria from at least 120 countries since the beginning of the conflict in 2012. As we saw in the November Paris attacks, returning foreign fighters with firsthand battlefield experience pose a dangerous operational threat. ISIL has demonstrated sophisticated attack tactics and tradecraft. ISIL, including its 8 established and several more emerging branches, has become the preeminent global terrorist threat. They have attempted or conducted scores of attacks outside of Syria and Iraq in the past 15 months. ISIL's estimated strength worldwide exceeds that of Al-Qaeda. ISIL's leaders are determined to strike the U.S. homeland beyond inspiring homegrown violent extremist attacks. Although the U.S. is a much harder target than Europe, ISIL external operations remain a critical factor in our threat assessments for 2016. Al-Qaeda's affiliates also have proven resilient. Despite counterterrorism pressure that's largely decimated the core leadership in Afghanistan and Pakistan, Al-Qaeda affiliates are positioned to make gains in 2016. Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, or AQAP, and the al-Nusra Front, the Al-Qaeda chapter in Syria, are the two most capable Al-Qaeda branches. The increased use by violent extremists of encrypted and secure internet and mobile-based technologies enables terrorist actors to, quote, go dark and serves to undercut intelligence and law enforcement efforts. Iran continues to be the foremost state sponsor of terrorism and exert its influence in regional crises in the Mideast through the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps Quds Force, its terrorist partner Lebanese Hezbollah, and proxy groups. Iran and Hezbollah remain a continuing terrorist threat to U.S. interests and partners worldwide. We saw firsthand the threat posed in the United States by homegrown violent extremists in the July attack in Chattanooga and the attack in San Bernardino. In 2014, the FBI arrested 9 ISIL supporters. In 2015, that number increased over fivefold. Turning to weapons of mass destruction, North Korea continues to conduct test activities of concern to the United States. On Saturday evening, Pyongyang conducted a satellite launch and subsequently claimed that the satellite was successfully placed in orbit. Additionally, last month, North Korea carried out its fourth nuclear test, claiming it was a hydrogen bomb, but the yield was too low for it to have been a successful test of a staged thermonuclear device. Pyongyang continues to produce fissile material and develop a submarine-launched ballistic missile. It is also committed to developing a long-range nuclear-armed missile that's capable of posing a direct threat to the United States, although the system has not been flight-tested. Despite its economic challenges, Russia continues its aggressive military modernization program. It continues to have the largest and most capable foreign nuclear-armed ballistic missile force. It has developed a cruise missile that violates the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces, or INF Treaty. China, for its part, continues to modernize its nuclear missile force and is striving for a secure second strike capability, although it continues to profess a no-first-use doctrine. The Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or JCPOA, provides us much greater transparency into Iran's fissile material production. It increases the time the Iranians would need to produce enough highly enriched uranium for a nuclear weapon from a few months to about a year. Iran probably views the JCPOA as a means to remove sanctions while preserving nuclear capabilities. Iran's perception of how the JCPOA helps it achieve its overall strategic goals will dictate the level of its adherence to the agreement over time. Chemical weapons continue to pose a threat in Syria and Iraq. Damascus has used chemicals against the opposition on multiple occasions since Syria joined the Chemical Weapons Convention. ISIL has also used toxic chemicals in Iraq and Syria, including the blister agent sulfur mustard. First time an extremist group has produced and used a chemical warfare agent in an attack since Aung San Suu Kyi used sarin in Japan in 1995. In space and counterspace, about 80 countries are now engaged in the space domain. Russia and China understand how our military fights and how heavily we rely on space. They're each pursuing destructive and disruptive anti-satellite systems. China continues to make progress on its anti-satellite missile program. Moving to counterintelligence, the threat from foreign intelligence entities, both state and non-state, is persistent, complex, and evolving. Targeting and collection of U.S. political, military, economic, and technical information by foreign intelligence services continues unabated. Russia and China pose the greatest threat, followed by Iran and Cuba on a lesser scale. As well, the threat from insiders taking advantage of their access to collect and remove sensitive national security information will remain a persistent challenge for us. I do want to touch on one transnational crime issue, specifically drug trafficking. Southwest border seizures of heroin in the United States have doubled since 2010. Over 10,000 people died of heroin overdoses in 2014. Much of it laced with fentanyl, which is 30 to 50 times more potent than heroin. In that same year, more than 28,000 died from opioid overdoses. And cocaine production in Colombia, from which most U.S. supplies originate, has increased significantly. Now, let me quickly move through a few regional issues. In East Asia, China's leaders are pursuing an active foreign policy while dealing with much slower economic growth. Chinese leaders have also embarked on the most ambitious military reforms in China's history. Regional tension will continue as China pursues construction at its outposts in the South China Sea. Russia has demonstrated its military capabilities to project itself as a global power, command respect from the West, maintain domestic support for the regime, and advance Russian interests globally. Moscow's objectives in Ukraine will probably remain unchanged, including maintaining long-term influence over Kiev and frustrating its attempts to integrate into Western institutions. Putin is the first leader since Stalin to expand Russia's territory. Moscow's military venture into Syria marks its first use since its foray into Afghanistan of significant expeditionary combat power outside the post-Soviet space. Its interventions demonstrate the improvements in Russian military capabilities and the Kremlin's confidence in using them. Moscow faces the reality, however, of economic recession driven in large part by falling oil prices as well as sanctions. Russia's nearly 4% GDP contraction last year will probably extend into 2016. In the Middle East and South Asia, there are more cross-border military operations underway in the Mideast than at any time since the 1973 Arab-Israeli War. Anti-ISL forces in Iraq will probably make incremental gains through this spring, similar to those made in Beji and Ramadi in the past few months. ISIL is now somewhat on the defensive, and its territory and manpower are shrinking, but it remains a formidable threat. In Syria, pro-regime forces have the initiative, having made some strategic gains near Aleppo and Latakia in the north, as well as in southern Syria. Manpower shortages will continue to undermine the Syrian regime's ability to accomplish strategic battlefield objectives. The opposition has less equipment and firepower, and its groups lack unity. They sometimes have competing battlefield interests and fight among themselves. In the meantime, some 250,000 people have been killed as this war has dragged on. The humanitarian situation in Syria continues to deteriorate. As of last month, there are approximately 4.4 million Syrian refugees and another 6.5 million internally displaced persons, which together represent about half of Syria's pre-conflict population. In Libya, despite the December agreement to form a new government of national accord, establishing authority and security across the country will be difficult, to put it mildly, with hundreds of militia groups operating throughout the country. ISIL has established its most developed branch outside of Syria and Iraq in Libya and maintains a presence in Sirte, Benghazi, Tripoli, and other areas in the country. The Yemeni conflict will probably remain stalemated through at least mid-2016. Meanwhile, AQAP and ISIL's affiliates in Yemen have exploited the conflict and the collapse of government authority to recruit and expand territorial control. The country's economic and humanitarian situation also continues to worsen. Iran deepened its involvement in the Syrian, Iraq, and Yemeni conflicts in 2015. It also increased military cooperation with Russia, highlighted by its battlefield alliance in Syria in support of the regime. Iran's supreme leader continues to view the United States as a major threat. We assess that his views will not change despite the implementation of the JCPOA deal, the exchange of detainees, and the release of the 10 sailors. In South Asia, Afghanistan is at serious risk of a political breakdown during 2016, occasioned by mounting political, economic, and security challenges. Waning political cohesion, increasingly assertive local power brokers, financial shortfalls, and sustained countrywide Taliban attacks are eroding stability. Needless to say, there are many more threats to U.S. interests worldwide that we can address, most of which are covered in our statement for the record, but I will stop my litany of doom here and pass to General Stewart.
General Stewart.
Chairman McCain, ranking members, ranking member Reed, members of the committee, thank you for this opportunity to provide the Defense Intelligence Agency's assessment of global security environment and the threats facing the nation. Mr. Chairman, my statement for the record details a range of multifaceted challenges, adversaries, threats, foreign military capabilities, and transnational terrorist networks. Taken together, these issues reflect the diversity, scope, and complexity of today's challenges to our national security. In my opening remarks, I'd like to highlight just a few of these threats. The Islamic State and the Levant. With coalition forces engaged against the Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, DIA is helping the warfighter and our policymakers better understand both the ideology and the capabilities of ISIL. ISIL, as well as like-minded extremists, are born out of the same extreme and violent Sunni Salafist ideology. These Salafi jihadists are determined to restore the caliphate, and as they have shown, are willing to justify extreme violence in their efforts to impose their social order on others. As the Paris attacks demonstrated, ISIL has become the most significant terrorist threats to the United States and our allies. In 2015, the group remained entrenched in Iraq and Syria and expanded globally. Spectacular external attacks demonstrate ISIL's relevance and reach and are a key part of their narrative. ISIL will probably attempt to conduct additional attacks in Europe and attempt to direct attacks on the U.S. homeland in 2016. ISIL's foreign fighter cadre is core to its external attack capability, and a large number of Western jihadists in Iraq and Syria will pose a challenge for Western security services. On the ground in Syria and Iraq, ISIL continues to control large swaths of territory. In 2015, coalition airstrikes impeded ISIL's ability to operate openly in Iraq and Syria, curtailed its use of conventional military equipment, and forced it to lower its profile. In 2016, the growing number of anti-ISIL forces and emerging resource shortfalls will probably challenge ISIL's ability to govern in Iraq and Syria. However, the group will probably retain Sunni Arab urban centers. In Afghanistan, in their first full year in the lead, Afghan security forces increasingly conducted independent operations. However, these forces struggled to adapt to a lack of coalition enablers and a high operational tempo, which led to uneven execution of operations. As a result, insurgents expanded their influence in rural areas, limiting the extension of government control. The deployment of Afghan specialized units and their enablers will be necessary to continue securing key population centers. In Russia, Russian military activity has continued at historical high. Moscow continues to pursue aggressive foreign and defense policies, including conducting operations in Syria, sustaining involvement in Ukraine, and expanding military capabilities in the Arctic. Last year, the Russian military continued its robust exercise schedule and aggressively and occasionally provocative out-of-area deployments. We anticipate similar high levels of military activity in 2016. China is pursuing a long-term comprehensive military modernization program to advance its core interests, which include maintaining its sovereignty, protecting its territorial integrity, and projecting its regional influence, particularly in the South China Sea. In addition to modernizing equipment and operations, the PLA is undergoing massive structural reforms, including increasing the number of Navy, Air Force, and Rocket Force personnel, establishing a theater joint command system, and reducing their current military regions down to 5 joint theater of operations. China has the world's largest and most comprehensive missile force and has prioritized their development and deployment of regional ballistic and cruise missiles to expand its conventional strike capabilities against U.S. forces in the region, and they field an anti-ship ballistic missile which provides the capability to attack U.S. aircraft carriers in the Western Pacific Ocean. China also displayed a new intermediate-range ballistic missile capable of striking Guam during its September 2015 military parade in Beijing. North Korea's nuclear weapons program and evolving ballistic missile programs are a continuing threat. In early January, North Korea issued a statement claiming that it had successfully carried out a nuclear test. And a couple days ago, they conducted their 6th space launch. This launch was the second launch to place a satellite into orbit. The DPRK displayed a new or modified mobile ICBM during their recent parade, and its 2015 test of a new submarine launch ballistic missile capability further highlight Pyongyang's commitment to diversifying its missile force and nuclear delivery options. North Korea also continues its effort to expand its stockpile of weapons-grade fissile material. In space, China and Russia increasingly recognize the strategic value of space and are focused on diminishing our advantage with the intent of denying the U.S. the use of space in the event of conflict. Both countries are conducting anti-satellite research and developing anti-satellite weapons, making the space domain increasingly competitive, contested, and congested. In cyberspace, DIA remains concerned about the growing capabilities of advanced state actors, such as Russia and China. These actors target DoD personnel, networks, supply chain, research and development, and critical infrastructure information in cyber domain. Iran and North Korea also remain a significant threat to conduct disruptive cyberspace attacks. Non-state actors' use of cyberspace to recruit, propagandize, and conduct open source research remains a significant challenge. Mr. Chairman, the men and women of your DIA are providing unique defense intelligence around the world and around the clock to warfighters, defense planners, the defense acquisition community, and policymakers to provide warning and defeat these and other threats. I look forward to the committee's questions.
Thank you very much, General. Director Clapper, in all these many decades you have served this country, have you ever seen more diverse or serious challenges to this country's security?
No, sir, I have not. I've said that something like that virtually every year. I've been up here. This is my fifth or sixth time, and I decided to leave it out this year because it's kind of a cliche, but it's actually true. That in my 50-plus years in the intelligence business, I cannot recall a more diverse array of challenges and crises that we confront as we do today.
And your job has been made considerably more difficult because of sequestration.
Yes, sir, it has. And I think the biggest problem with it, frankly, over time, is the uncertainty that it injects in the context of planning, and particularly, and it plays havoc with systems acquisition. So it's the uncertainty factor that we now have that has also become a normal fact of planning and programming.
Thank you. Just in the last few days, the issue of torture has arisen again. General David Petraeus made a statement that I'd like to quote to you. He says, "Our nation has paid a high price in recent decades for the information gained by the use of techniques beyond those in the field manual. And in my view, that price far outweighed the value of the information gained through the use of techniques, i.e. waterboarding, beyond those in the manual." The manual obviously prohibits waterboarding and other forms of torture. Do you agree with General Petraeus's assessment?
I do. I believe the Army Field Manual is the standard, and that is what we should abide by. It serves the purposes of both providing a framework for the elicitation of valuable intelligence information, and it comports with American values.
That's the point, I think. Isn't it the fact that this is American values are such that just no matter what the enemy does, that we maintain a higher standard of behavior, and when we violate that, as we did with Abu Ghraib, that the consequences are severe?
Yes, sir.
An erosion of our moral authority.
I would agree with that.
Isn't it already proven that Mr. Baghdadi is sending people with this flow of refugees that are terrorists, that in order to inflict further attacks on Europe and the United States?
That's correct. That's one technique they've used, is taking advantage of the torrent of migrants to insert operatives into that flow. As well, they also have available to them and are pretty skilled at phony passports, so they can travel ostensibly as legitimate travelers as well.
And they're pretty good at establishing secure sites for them to continue to communicate.
That's true. I alluded to that in my opening statement about the impacts of encryption and the growth of encrypted applications, which has having a negative impact on intelligence gathering. I recently traveled to Texas, and this is affecting not only us in the national security realm, but the state and local officials as well.
As you know, in addition to the Atlas rocket, which uses the Russian RD-180 rocket engine, the United Launch Alliance also maintains an American rocket with an American engine. As we continue to have this important debate about how to break our nation's dependency on Russia for our national security space launch, do you believe we need to look seriously at that American rocket, the Delta, as an alternative way to get off the RD-180 and encourage competition from other organizations capable of providing us with this ability?
I'm a customer, Chairman McCain, of the launch industry in the United States. My interest is in seeing to it that our overhead reconnaissance constellation is replenished and replenished on time. And there is a capability with the Delta that, as you allude, which is, we think, from our standpoint, since we pay the freight when we use these systems, which is both effective and cost efficient. And I certainly do agree on, you know, fundamental American tenet of competition. That's why I'm quite encouraged by the aggressive approach that SpaceX has taken. And our plan is to certify SpaceX for carrying national security payloads into space.
And it's not in our interest in any way to continue our dependency on Russian rocket engines.
Just speaking as a citizen, I'd rather we didn't. We weren't dependent on the RD-180s. We have been, and they've worked for us. And again, my interest, though, is getting those payloads up on time.
Thank you very much, Senator Reid.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. General Clapper, to date, what's your assessment of the compliance by the Iranians with the JCPOA, the community?
Well, right now, I think the key milestone here was implementation day on the 16th of January, and the Iranians did comply with the requirements that they were required to live up to. I think we in the intelligence community are very much in the distrust and verify mode. There are half a dozen or so ambiguities, maybe others, but certainly half a dozen or so ambiguities in the agreement that we have identified, and we're going to be very vigilant about Iranian compliance.
Well, that's exactly what you should be doing, and I commend you for that. Just going forward, are you confident that you could detect a serious deviation from the agreements in sufficient time to give the executive options?
Yes, sir. I am confident. My fingerprints are on the infamous Weapons of Mass Destruction National Intelligence Estimate of October 2002. I was serving in another capacity then. So I think we approach this with confidence, but also with institutional humility.
Thank you, sir. There are many challenges that are being posed by the Russians, but the Russians are facing a challenge of unexpectedly low oil prices that seem to be continuing. Has the intelligence community made an assessment of the impact, medium to long term, on this, on the ability of the Russians to maintain their military posture and their provocative actions?
Well, the price of oil has had the falling price of oil has had huge impact on the Russian economy. It's the price of Ural crude is running around $28 a barrel. The Russians' planning factor for their planning and programming for their budget is around $50 a barrel. So this is causing all kinds of strain. If you look at all the classical measurements of economic measures, inflation, the value of the ruble, which has sunk to an all-time low, unemployment, stresses on their welfare system, et cetera, et cetera. That said, the Russians appear to be sustaining their commitment to their aggressive modernization program, particularly in the with their strategic missiles.
Looking ahead, though, is there any indication, or this is an area that you're picking up information through many sources that are reflecting great concern by the Russians and their ability to keep this up, or looking
at? Well, that determination will be made by one man. I think for lots of reasons he will sustain the expeditionary activity in Syria, although I think perhaps even the Russians are seeing that this is headed for stalemate in the absence of a substantial ground force insertion, which I don't believe the Russians are disposed to do.
Thank you. Quickly changing topics in the remaining minute and a half, in Afghanistan, multiple challenges. President Ghani is trying to pursue a reconciliation with the Taliban. And in that regard, there's at least a four-nation process, China, Pakistan, the United States, and Afghanistan. Any insights about the possibility of reconciliation or the motivation of any of the parties to this action?
Well, I think that, you know, the Taliban position has consistently been not to do that, not to negotiate. The precondition they always ascribe is the removal of foreign forces, and I don't see them changing that position.
Thank you very much. General Stewart, thank you for your distinguished service. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a very accurate litany of doom. You covered a lot of stuff in a short period of time. We'll have to go back and reread that. When you look at what right now, we're kind of in a situation where Russia is pursuing new concepts and capabilities, expanding the role of nuclear weapons as security strategy. That's a quote out of the U.S. National Intelligence Council. You covered that also briefly in your opening remarks. When we talk to people on the outside and they say, you know, you have Russia stating they're going to make these advances, they're going to modernize, and yet we have a policy where we're not doing it. What's a justification? What kind of answer can we give people who ask that question, including me?
Well, sir, that's a policy issue. I worry about the adversaries. I've used this metaphor before this committee, but General Stewart and I and the rest of the intelligence community are just down the engine room shoveling intelligence coal, yeah. And people on the bridge get to decide where the ship goes and how fast, and arrange the furniture on the deck. So that's a policy issue that others decide.
Well, I personally don't think it's a good policy, but we all have opinions on that. I was fortunate enough to be over in Ukraine back when Poroshenko and Yatsenyuk were successful in their parliamentary elections, and first time in 96 years there's not one communist in the parliament. That's really kind of exciting, although I was upset with our lack of, when Putin came in and started killing people, with our lack of support at that time as a policy for Ukraine. As we're looking at it now, and there's been statements made from Russia saying that as the NATO becomes more aggressive and we become more aggressive, they're going to become more aggressive. Does it look to you like that's going on right now, and what will be the end game of that?
I think answer your last question on what the end game is, I don't know, but I will say that the Russians, I might ask General Stewart to comment on this, but I think the Russians fundamentally are paranoid about NATO. They're greatly concerned about being contained, and of course, very, very concerned about missile defense, which would serve to neuter what is the essence of their claim to great power status, which is their nuclear arsenal. So a lot of these aggressive things that the Russians are doing for a number of reasons, great power status, to create the image of being co-equal with the United States, et cetera, I think could probably possibly go on, and we could be into another Cold War-like spiral here.
Well, that Cold War, I was thinking of that at the time. Isn't that what we went through for such a long period of time, where you had Russia or USSR making the statements and preparing themselves and wanting to outdo us? I mean, just for the image. I see this as something kind of similar to that. Director Clapper, in your prepared statement, you said that, and this is a quote, U.S. air campaigns have made significant gains in ISIL, and then we have reports that the U.S. fights against ISIL is actually benefiting al-Qaeda. Is there a relationship, or what is that relationship between al-Qaeda and ISIL?
Well, I've seen that. I don't know that I could say that airstrikes against ISIL are somehow benefiting al-Qaeda, because we're still keeping the pressure on al-Qaeda.
You're familiar with those reports, though.
I've read them.
Yeah.
I'm not sure I would subscribe to them. There have been, I think we have, there has been progress made against ISIL in its Iraq, Syria incarnation, because that assumes some of the accoutrements or characteristics of a nation state, and that in turn presents vulnerabilities that we can exploit. I think the important thing is to keep the pressure on multiple fronts and keep attacking those things which are near and dear to ISIL, which is the oil infrastructure that it owns and its access to money.
Yeah, one last question. My time's expired, but the RD-180 issue. That's one we're all looking at, and I think there is a recognition that we need to keep using for a period of time as we make any transition that might be in the future. Now, we have in the Defense Authorization Bill of 16, I guess it was, we talked about 9 additional ones. I think the Air Force has requested at one point in some form 18 additional ones. What is your thinking about that, the transition?
Well, I'll tell you, Senator, position here is I'm a user or customer. I have to have certain payloads delivered on time to sustain the health and viability of our overhead reconnaissance system, which is extremely important to the nation's security. And I don't get into too much other than I have to pay the bills, because I pay the Air Force whenever we avail ourselves of their launch services. How they design their systems, that's kind of up to them. I'm interested in delivery. The Delta has worked great for us. It appears to me to be cost efficient, and it is effective in terms of when we've used it, it delivers.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. I want to join my colleagues in thanking both of you for your extraordinary service to our nation. Director Clapper, you made the point in response to Senator Reid and also in your testimony that the international community is, in your words, well postured to detect any violation by Iran of the nuclear agreement. Has there been any indication so far that it is moving toward a violation?
No. Not yet. We have no evidence thus far that they're moving towards violation.
And I'm sure you would agree that this nation and the international community need to be vigilant and vigorous in enforcing this agreement.
Absolutely, sir. As I said earlier, I think we in the U.S. intelligence community are in the distrust and verify mode.
And the distrust and verify mode includes not only the IAEA, but also other investigative tools that you have at your disposal.
Absolutely.
Going to the ballistic missile issue, which I believe is profoundly important, and General Stewart makes this point in his testimony as well, I urge the President to impose sanctions and enforce them as a result of Iran's continued development of ballistic missiles, which are a threat not only to the region, but also to our allies in Europe. And fortunately, he has heeded those calls from myself and letters that were joined by my colleagues. How important do you think it is that we continue to enforce sanctions in response to Iran's development of ballistic missiles?
I think it's quite important that sanctions be enforced, not only for missiles, but for terrorism or any other things that are covered under sanctions. The Iranians have a very formidable missile capability, which they continue to work on. They fired some 140 or so missiles since the original UNSC resolution 1929 of 2010. And about half of those firings were going on during the negotiations, which, were, of course, were, as you know, were separate from the actual negotiations. So for our part, this is a challenge that we must attend to by being as vigilant as possible on gleaning intelligence about these capabilities and reporting that to our policymakers.
And speaking for myself, and I believe my view is joined by other colleagues, I will continue to insist on vigorous enforcement of those sanctions because of the threat that you have very powerfully outlined. General Stewart, in your testimony, you make the point that the economic relief that Iran will see as a result of the JCPOA is unlikely in the short term to increase its military capability. Is that correct?
I think it is unlikely immediately, because I believe that the focus will be on internal economic gains. However, after 35 years of sanction, Iran has developed, as we just discussed, the most capable missile force in the region. It's extended its lethality, its accuracy. It's got all the ranges covered. It can reach all of its regional targets. In the long term, I fully expect that they'll invest some of the money into improving the rest of their military capabilities.
What is the long term? In other words, how many years is long term?
Yeah.
Are we talking 5 years, 10 years? And secondly, what should be our response, and I believe it has to be a robust and strong response, to that increase in longer-term military capabilities that threatens our allies and friends in the region, most particularly Israel, with terrorism and other conventional military capabilities, as well as the kinds of counter-incentives we can provide?
So the long-term might not be even as far as 5 years. We've already seen an agreement between Iran and the Russians for the S-300 air defense system. We're seeing Russia demonstrate tremendous capabilities as they've done their out-of-area deployment into Syria. So there's lots of weapons technology being displayed, and I suspect within the next 2 to 5 years, we can expect Iran to invest in some of those weapons technology that's being displayed in the Syrian battlefield by the Russians today.
And what should be our response?
I think I'm going to punt that to the policymakers on the response to how Iran arms and how they might use this weapons capability.
You would agree that we should respond robustly and strongly?
I would agree that we should have a policy to be prepared to respond appropriately.
Thank you. Thank you, General. Thank you, Director Clapper.
On behalf of the Chairman, Senator Sessions.
Thank you, Senator Reid. Well, we thank both of you for your service. Director Clapper, thank you for your decades of service to the country, and that's something we all respect and value. General Stewart, I appreciate seeing you again. You've been in the battlefield, and you've seen it from both sides and know the importance of intelligence. Director Clapper, it seems to me that we are about to see a tremendous expansion of proliferation, and the numbers actually of weapons and the countries that possess nuclear weapons. It's something that the world is united behind trying to stop. The UN and the whole world, NATO, has fought to maintain a limited number of nations with nuclear weapons, and we've been particularly concerned about nuclear weapons in the Middle East. Where do we stand on that from a strategic position? Your best judgment of the risk we're now facing?
Well, of course, you worry about North Korea in this respect. And I think in the Mideast, I think the agreement, the JCPOA, which does prevent, if it's complied with, a nuclear capability in Iran, at least in the foreseeable future. That should serve as a tempering factor for the likes of, for other countries that may feel threatened if, in fact, Iran proceeded on with its nuclear weapons program.
Well, we've got India and Pakistan. Secretary Kissinger testified here a year ago, I suppose, in which he said that we could see multiple nations in the Middle East move toward nuclear weapons. And we do know that North Korea will sell weapon technology, do we not, and have done so in the past?
That's true that particularly North Korea is a proliferator. That's one of the principal ways they attempt to generate revenue is through proliferation. I worry, frankly, about more mundane things like man pads, which the North Koreans produce and proliferate throughout the world, which poses a great threat to aviation. So I think our role in the intelligence community is to be as vigilant as we can about this and report when proliferants spread. And that it is a great concern, and certainly particularly in the Mideast.
Thank you. That is a serious subject. General Stewart, tell us where we stand in Iraq. You served there, and you were involved with the Sunnis in Al Anbar province. You saw them flip and become turned against Al-Qaeda. Can we replicate that now? And what are the prospects for the Sunnis once again turning against the terrorist?
I think if the Sunnis believe that they have a real prospect, either for an involvement with the Iraqi government or some other confederation construct where their views and interests are represented, I think they'll likely turn against ISIL. I don't think that that message has been effectively communicated yet. I think Abadi would like a more inclusive government, but I'm not sure that he has all of the members of his ruling body behind such inclusivity. Until that occurs, then the Sunni tribes are very likely to remain either on the fence or choose the least worst option, which is to not antagonize and maybe even support ISIL in the western part of Iraq.
But that would be the decisive action that needs to occur, that once again, the decisive action would be if the Sunnis would turn against ISIL as they turned against Al-Qaeda.
I think that would absolutely be decisive, but I think they'll be very cautious to ensure that we will not leave them hanging out there after they've turned against ISIL. This is pure pragmatism. If we're not successful, we're not supportive of the Sunni tribes, they will die. Al-Qaeda or ISIL will be brutal, they'll be ruthless. And so if we're going to support them, we're going to try to convince them to turn and fight against ISIL, then we have to have the true commitment of the government of Iraq and all of the parties who encourage them to fight against ISIL, because this is purely about survival for those tribes.
And that in our effort to push back against ISIL would be an extremely important action, development.
Yes, sir, I believe it would be.
What about Mosul, a city of a million, that would not have the heritage of ISIL and that kind of extremism? Well, what are the prospects for turning the situation around in Mosul and freeing Mosul from ISIL's?
I'm less optimistic in the near term about Mosul. I think there's lots of work to be done yet out in the western part. I don't believe that Ramadi is completely secure, so they have to secure Ramadi. They have to secure the Hadith corridor in order to have some opportunity to fully encircle and bring all the forces against Mosul. Mosul will be a complex operations, and so I'm not as optimistic. As you say, it's a large city. I'm not as optimistic that we'll be able to turn that in the near term. In my view, certainly not this year. We may be able to begin the campaign, do some isolation operations around Mosul, but securing or taking Mosul is an extensive operation and not something I see in the next year or so.
Thank you very much, General Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Welcome back, Director Clapper, General Stewart. Thank you for that predictably cheery briefing. Director Clapper, I've always believed that the ground war against ISIS must be won by our Arab partners rather than by American ground forces. And so it was therefore pretty encouraging to finally hear Saudi Arabia and the UAE over the weekend voice some openness to putting ground forces in Syria. What's the intelligence community's assessment of the capability of Saudi and UAE ground forces, and how realistic do you think this proposal is? In other words, do you assess that they actually have the political will to potentially do that?
Well, let me start with the UAE, which is a very, very capable military, although small. The performance of their counterterrorist forces in Yemen have been quite impressive. I think certainly appreciate and value the Saudi willingness to engage on the ground. I think that will be a challenge, would be a challenge for them if they were to try to take that on.
Okay. If I could add,
absolutely.
Fully concur with the UAE forces, whether they have the capacity to do both Yemen and something in Iraq, Syria, is questionable for me. Yeah. I think they're having a tough, they're doing extremely well in Yemen, but the capacity to do more is pretty limited.
Thank you both. Director Clapper, one of the things we've been struggling with, obviously, is trying to crack down on ISIS's financing. They have multiple sources of revenue that include illicit oil sales, taxation, extortion of the local population, looting of banks, personal property, smuggling of antiquities, and to a lesser extent, even kidnapping for ransom and foreign donations. I'm certainly pleased to see some progress has been made where the U.S. coalition forces have escalated tactics by targeting wellheads, targeting road tankers, even cash storage sites. These efforts have certainly helped force ISIS to cut its fighters' pay, in some reports by up to 50%. What additionally do you believe that we can be doing to further restrict their financial resources?
I think the main, sir, you've outlined pretty much the sources of revenue for ISIS, and they have a very elaborate bureaucracy for managing their money. And I think the important thing is to sustain that pressure on multiple dimensions, to include going after the oil infrastructure. Now, the ISIL has displayed great ingenuity by setting up thousands of these mom and pop refineries.
Yep.
And we have to stay at it. And as well, the recent bombing of the financial institution in Mosul had big impact on them. I think we're starting to see some success with the Iraqi government in reducing payments to Iraqi citizens who live in ISIL-controlled areas. There's a downside to that. When they do that, that potentially alienates them further about the central government, Baghdad. But to me, the important aspect here and the important theme would be to sustain the pressure.
You know, one of the sources that has been, I guess, surprisingly consequential is black market antiquity sales from the looting that's occurred. It's my understanding that the U.S. has sanctions that it can impose on anyone who imports antiquities stolen by ISIS, but it doesn't have separate abilities to sanction individuals who actually purchase looted Syrian antiquities. Would it be helpful to authorize sanctions that are not just against the buyer or the seller of those, but against the middlemen who are involved?
I would want to take that under advisement and consult with my colleagues in the Department of Treasury, but I would tell you that in the relative scheme of things, the sale of antiquities is not a big revenue generator, and it's really kind of tapered off some. But I'd be for exploring whatever ways we can pressure the ISIL financially, we should.
Great. Thank you both.
I want to thank you both for your service. I want to thank you, Director Clapper, for your many decades of service to our country. We appreciate it. I wanted to follow up on your written statement where in it, and I think you reiterated it today, that Iran probably views the JCPOA as a means to remove sanctions while preserving some of its nuclear capabilities. And in the second part, you said, as well as the option to eventually expand its nuclear infrastructure. Can you expound on that?
Well, as the period of the agreement plays out, I think we should expect that the Iraqis will want to push the margins on R&D they've already done work on research and development on centrifuge design. Now they've sustained the position they've taken, this one man that makes the decision here is the supreme leader, that they're not going to pursue nuclear weapons. But there are many other things they could do in a nuclear context that serves to enhance their technology and their expertise.
Let me ask you, we saw Iran have ballistic missile tests on October 10th and November 21st, post-JCPOA, and even pre-receiving the sanctions cash relief that they recently received of billions of dollars. We also know that recently North Korea had a space launch continuing to develop their ICBM program. And I wanted to ask you, first of all, we know that in your statement you've mentioned and historically that there has been cooperation between North Korea and Iran on their ballistic missile program. Can you tell us what that cooperation has been? And can we expect that North Korea will sell or share technology with Tehran that could expedite Iran's development of ICBM missiles?
Of late, I have to be mindful of the setting here. There has not been a great deal of interchange between Iraq and Iran, or between North Korea and Iran, on the subject of nuclear missile capabilities, but there has been in the past. We have been reasonably successful in detecting this, so hopefully we'll, with appropriate vigilance, we'll be able to sustain that.
Let me ask
North
you,
Koreans,
sorry.
Though, will they're interested in cash, and this is one of their
And we now problems. Know Iran has more cash, correct?
Well, they do now, but as General Stewart indicated, a lot of the cash, at least in the initial tranche, is encumbered. The Iranians have a lot of obligations to fulfill economically.
Let me follow up on the two. What do you make of the fact that the Iranians did, in fact, post JCPOA, in violation of existing UN resolutions, make two launches of ballistic missiles, and I think you were asked about the sanctions that were put in place. Let's just be clear, those sanctions weren't very tough. Do you think that those are going to deter Iran from continuing to develop its ICBM program?
Well, the Iranians have conducted some 140 launches since the original UN Security Council resolution 1929 that was imposed in 2010. And so 70 of those, about half of them, were done during the negotiations, given the fact that the missiles weren't a part of the negotiations. So as far as these two launches are concerned, I think this was a deliberate message of defiance, and that the Iranians are going to continue with an aggressive program to develop their missile force.
And as you and I have talked about in the past, just to be clear, we judge that Tehran would choose ballistic missiles as its preferred method of delivering nuclear weapons if it builds them. That is obviously why you would build a ballistic missile if you choose to build a nuclear weapon.
Well, they have hundreds of them
right.
That threaten the Mideast. And, of course, the two under development could potentially, given the technology, although the immediate one that's most, I guess, the most proximate that would be launched. The GAM is built by civilians and is ostensibly for a space launch.
I only have 5 seconds left, but I want to follow up on the heroin question. I believe you said that heroin and fentanyl, which is, of course, 30 to 50 times more powerful, is coming over our southern border, and that has doubled by the Mexican drug cartels going back to 2010. Do you believe that that's something that we, General Kelly has raised this when he was a commander of Southcom, as that delivery system and those cartels could actually deliver almost anything with the sophisticated networks they have established? But do you believe we should be focused also on more interdiction, particularly on the heroin problem at the southern
border? I do, and what the experience, at least what I've observed, and I think General Kelly has said this consistently when he testified, is that it wasn't for lack of intelligence, it was lack of operational capacity to actually react and interdict. And so we, you know, I'm a big fan of the Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard's done some great things. These new national security cutters are fantastic capability against drug for drug interdiction purposes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thanks to the witnesses. I have many questions to ask, but I think what I'll do is focus on one. I'm struggling with this, and I would love to hear your thoughts about low oil prices and how they affect our security posture. This is not in a litany of gloom. This is a good thing, but it's got some elements to it that are, I think, are challenging. I was in Israel once in April of 2010 and meeting with President Shimon Peres, and I asked him what would be the most important thing the U.S. could do to enhance security in the region. And he said, wean yourself off dependence on oil from the Middle East. And as I talked to him, his basic logic was, to the extent that we develop non-carbon alternatives or our own native energy sources, our demand for Middle Eastern oil would drop. We're a market leader. That would have an effect of reducing prices, and a lot of the nations in the Middle East, Iran and other nations, Russia or Venezuela, they've used high oil prices to finance bellicose adventurism, and if they get more strapped on the cash side, they have a harder time doing it. So we've seen a dramatic development in American native energy. We've seen development of non-carbon energy, and we've seen oil prices go to dramatic lows, and they're not going to stay there forever, but many are predicting that they're going to stay significantly lower than historic lows. It's good for American consumers. It's good for American businesses. It poses challenges for some of our principal adversaries, Russia, for example. It puts a cap on, to some degree, what Iran would get from being back in a global economy and selling their oil. But it also poses some risks as well. I've heard European counterparts say that they're really worried about an aggressive Russia, but they're even more worried about a economic basket case Russia. So from the intel side, as you look at intel and threats, talk a little bit about the prospect of low oil prices and any negatives associated with that, please.
Well, I think you've painted the picture pretty well, Senator Kaine. It's working, I guess you would say, one could say, to our advantage in Russia. I spoke about that earlier current price of Ural crude, for example, is $28 a barrel, when Russia's planning factor for their national budget is $50 a barrel. This has affected, for example, they have been unable to invest in the Arctic. So it's had profound impact and will, I think, for some time. Structurally in Russia. Venezuela is another case, a country that's been completely dependent almost for its revenue for a long time on oil revenue. And of course, with a precipitous drop in oil, this had a huge impact on their economy, which is statist managed anyway, and is laced with all kinds of subsidies for its people. Now they're facing insolvency. So that it has that effect, and of course, to the extent that we become independent and not dependent on anyone's oil, that's a good thing. country's caught in the middle, I think. It's going to be a mixed bag as to how well they manage themselves, where they are dependent on others for oil. If the price stays low, that's great. If it's hiked either by virtue of the natural forces or artificially, that could have a very deleterious impact on the economy, say, in Europe. So it's a very mixed picture.
Just a follow-up about Russia in particular. It seems that sometimes they're more likely to engage in some, you know, adventurism outside their country when their internal politics and economy is in trouble. I mean, Putin seems like a guy who, when things are going bad at home, he wants to divert attention, and whether it's throwing an Olympics or a World Cup or invading another country, that seems to be kind of a move that he'll make when he's got dissatisfaction at home driven by economic challenges. So is there some degree to which these lower oil prices, they negatively affect an adversary, but they may make them a little more unpredictable and hence dangerous?
That's true. And of course, all decision making in Russia is essentially done by one person. The Russians have a great capacity for enduring pain and suffering. The polls that are taken in Russia still indicate very high levels of popularity, 80% range for Putin. It is interesting, though, and his speeches of late and domestically have taken a different turn or a different tone, in that they are much more exhorting patriotic spirit and the great history of Russia as I think probably a way of diverting attention from poor economic performance of the Russian economy. And by any measure, you look at unemployment, inflation, the worth of the ruble, it's all-time low, and investment, et cetera. Whatever measure you want to use, it's all not good from a Russian perspective. Now, the issue would be, how does that affect the street? And at what point do people start turning out and demonstrating? Which that's what makes them very nervous. If people get organized and restive on a large scale throughout Russia, and Russians are very concerned about that.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Clapper, in your statement, you assess that foreign support will allow Damascus to make gains in some key areas this year. And General Stewart, you state that the Assad regime is unlikely to be militarily defeated or collapse in the near term, and it's poised to enter 2016 in a stronger military position against the opposition because of their increased support that they're receiving from Iran and Hezbollah and Russia. Given Assad's apparently improving fortunes that we're seeing, do you assess that he will negotiate any kind of transition from power?
He's certainly in a much stronger negotiating position than he was just 6 months ago. His forces, supported by Russian air forces, supported by Iranian and Hezbollah forces, are having some effect, but not decisive effect across the battlefield. They've isolated Aleppo, for instance, and are now sieging Aleppo. So he's in a much stronger negotiating position, and I'm more inclined to believe that he is a player on the stage longer term than he was 6 months to a year ago. He's in a much better position.
And General, how would you define longer term?
I think this one's interesting, because I think the Russians are very comfortable with the idea that if they have a regime that supports their interests in Syria, Bashar al-Assad might not be as important to them as Bashar al-Assad is far more important to the Iranians to maintain their relationship with Syria and status around Lebanon. So I think getting all the parties to agree on whether he should go, the timeline with which he should go, who might be a better alternative, because that's important to all of the parties, this is such a dynamic space, and then you throw the Turks in with their interest that Assad should go also. So I think long term, I'm not seeing any change in the status here for the next year or so. And beyond that, we'll see how the fight on the battlefield unfolds.
Before I turn to you, Director Clapper, General, when you mention about Iran and Moscow being able to work together on this, and maybe they're, what I heard was maybe they're diverging in their support for Assad in keeping him in power or giving him more leverage in a transition. Do you believe that is going to come to a head, again, in the short term, long term, and what are the consequences of that? I can remember, wasn't that long ago when we would all sit up here and say, it's not a question on if Assad is leaving, it's when he's leaving. That obviously has changed.
The Russian reinforcement has changed the calculus completely. The tactical relationship that Iran and Russia has today, I suspect at some point, and it's pretty hard to predict at some point, will diverge because they won't share the stage. Iran wants to be the regional hegemon. If it has to compete with Russia in the longer term, and again, I can't put months or years, I suspect that their interests will diverge because of competition as a regional power. In the near term, though, their interest is simply to prop up the regime, and the regime, in my mind, is not necessarily Assad. It's the regime, first of all, that allows Russia to maintain its interests and allows Iran to control Syria, greater Syria, and parts of Lebanon. When those two things become tension points where their interests, where Russia jettisons Assad or Russia pushes for his removal, I suspect that they will have at least a tactical breakdown. However, it's still in Iran's interest to maintain a relationship with Russia because of what we talked about earlier, the ability to procure weapons from Russia without any preconditions. And they would like to modernize all of their military forces, and Russia seems to be an option for doing that. So the relationship might be tense. It might break down at some point because of regional desires for control, but they'll still have an enduring relationship from a weapons procurement standpoint.
And Director Clapper, I'm out of time, but if you had just a couple comments you'd like to add there, I apologize for giving you less time.
That's fine. The thing that I find interesting is that both the Russians and the Iranians are growing increasingly interested in using proxies rather than their own forces to fight in Syria. The Russians are incurring casualties, the Iranians are, and so to the extent that they can bring in others, and of course in Iran's case, Hezbollah, I think Russians are not wedded to Assad personally. But they have the same challenge as everyone else, if not Assad, who? And I don't know that they've come up with an alternative to him either.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlemen, thank you for being with us this morning. I was discussing yesterday with one of our Five Eyes partners overall long-term intelligence and worldwide threats. I'm afraid, and you touched on this, Director Clapper, in your report, I'm afraid that the Syrian refugee crisis is a precursor of a larger refugee crisis that we could be facing over the next 10 to 20 years based upon predictions of climate change. The band of the world that is going to be subject to droughts, famine, crop loss, flooding in some areas, over incredible heat, in the band around North Africa, Central Africa, into Southeast Asia, we could see mass migrations that could really strain the Western countries. Would you concur in that, Secretary?
Well, I think you're quite right, and I alluded to that at least briefly in my oral statement about the fact that we have some 60 million people around the globe displaced in one way or another. And I think
if that increases, it's going to create, because all of those people are going to want to go where things are better.
Which exactly.
Which happens to be the northern hemisphere.
And so that's why that is going to, that will place ever greater stresses on the remainder of the countries, whether in, here in the Americas, Europe, Africa, Asia, wherever. And the effects of climate change, of weather aberrations, however you want to describe them, just exacerbate this. You know, what we have in the world is so by way of resource to feed and support the growing world population is somewhat of a finite resource. There's only so much water, only so much arable land. And so the conditions that you mentioned, I believe, are going to foment more pressure for migrants. That on top of the instability that of governance that I spoke briefly about in my oral statement as well, I think, are going to make for a challenging situation in the future.
Thank you. Again, turning to something that you touched on, the lack of capacity to deal with drug imports, it seems to me, is something that is a real strategic and tactical challenge. We're suffering terribly in my home state of Maine with heroin. New Hampshire has one death overdose a day. In Maine, it's 200 a year, one death every weekday, if you will. And we're trying to deal with the demand side and with the treatment and prevention, but keeping this stuff out to begin with, and heroin's cheaper than it's ever been, which tells me that the supply is up. Where should we be putting our efforts on the interdiction side?
Well, on to the extent, I think the working with the Mexican government, particularly since that's where a great deal of this comes from, is Mexico. And I think the partnership that we can engender with them is crucial to this.
Are they serious partner? Do they want to stop this, or are they conflicted? Do they see this as a cash crop?
Well, I think it depends on who they is in Mexico. I think the national leadership would obviously like to stop the flow. But there are very, as you know, very, very powerful economic forces in Mexico that augur against that. And we've got a lot of money. And so they also have a corruption problem, frankly, to deal with. So I think we need to be as aggressive as we can be in interdicting what we can. I mentioned earlier, for example, the tremendous impact of the Coast Guard capabilities when they're brought to bear. And as we discussed earlier, General Kelly, former commander of Southcom, spoken to this many times about not so much a lack of intelligence, but rather the lack of an operational capability to respond to the intelligence to interdict. We have the intelligence capability and the intelligence capacity, but it needs to be matched by a concomitant resource commitment.
We need a greater commitment in terms of interdiction capacity.
Exactly.
With just a few seconds left, and perhaps you could take this for the record, we always at these hearings talk about the cyber threat. We've done some actions here. We finally got through a cyber bill last year about information sharing. I'm still concerned about critical infrastructure. And perhaps for the record, you could give us some thoughts about what further we should be doing here in Congress or in the country in terms of critical infrastructure, because that's, I think, one of our areas of greatest vulnerability.
I share your concern, and we'll provide some for the record.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gentlemen, thank you both for your many years of service to our country. First, I'd like to say that it's reassuring to hear so many members of this committee who voted to give the world's worst state sponsor of terrorism tens of billions of dollars express their grave concerns about what Iran might do with that money. I wish we had heard more of those concerns during the debate and before the vote on it. Director Clapper, you testified last year that in your 45 years of public service, this was the worst global threat and environment you had ever seen. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, and I had occasion to say it again in response to a question earlier.
Yes, sir, and that was your point with Senator McCain earlier, is that it's the worst global threat environment now in 46 years.
Well, it's certainly the most diverse array of challenges and threats that I can recall.
Why is that?
Well, I think it's, frankly, it's somewhat of a function of the change in the bipolar system that that did provide a certain stability in the world, the Soviet Union and its community, its alliance, and the West, led by the United States, and virtually all other threats were sort of subsumed in that basic bipolar contest that, that went on for decades and was characterized by stability. When that ended, that set off a whole range of, group of forces, I guess, or dynamics around the world that have changed.
You both have long and deep experience in the Middle East. In your experience, is the Middle East a place that prizes concessions and negotiations or strength and toughness?
I would argue that in almost all these cases, strength is preferred over signs of weakness.
Do you believe that the appearance and reputation for power is an important part of the reality of power in national security affairs?
Yes, Senator.
What would you believe is our current reputation for power in the Middle East after, say, 10 American sailors were videotaped kneeling at gunpoint by Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps forces?
I don't know that that incident alone reflects the perception of our strength and power. I think over the last several years, there have been some concerns among our partners about our commitment to the region, our willingness to employ the force, where our interests, both national and strategic interests, lies. I think that's caused just a little bit of concern among our partners about our commitment to the region.
I would like to return to a question that Senator Heinrich raised. He raised the news that the Saudi Defense Ministry and now the Emirati Foreign Ministry have both suggested that they would be willing to deploy their troops to the ground in Syria, and he asked you to assess the capability of those militaries. But threats, for good or for ill, are part of are both capability and intention. In both of the statements from Saudi Arabia and the UAE, they both insisted that they would need to see U.S. leadership in that effort. Director Clapper, do you have any idea what kind of leadership they're talking about, what more they would expect to see from the United States that they apparently are not seeing at the moment?
Well, I don't know what, I took it to mean specifically with respect to if they deployed a significant military force into Syria. And I took it to mean the command and control capability that you know, the U.S. is pretty good at. That's what I took it to mean.
General Stewart.
I think the Arab countries, led by Saudi Arabia and the Emiratis, would like to see more ground forces to match their commitment. Having said that, I do not assess that the Saudi ground forces would have either the capacity to take this fight on. As I've said earlier, the Emiratis, very capable, acquitted themselves well in Yemen, lacked the capacity to take on additional fight elsewhere. I think the idea is, how do we get more U.S. skin in the game?
Thank you. Director Clapper, in early October, shortly after Russia began its incursion to Syria, President Obama called it, quote, a big mistake and, quote, doomed to fail. Do you believe 4.5 months later that Russia's incursion into Syria is a big mistake from their standpoint and doomed to fail?
It could be a big mistake. And one of the concerns the Russians have, of course, those with long memories, is a repeat of Afghanistan. And of course, that's why the Russians to this point have avoided a significant ground force presence. They have about 5,000 personnel tied up in supporting the air operations, advisors, intelligence, et cetera. So long term, it could be a mistake for them. They haven't enjoyed the success, I think, that Putin anticipated. I think he believed that he would go in quickly and and leave and be able to leave early, and that is not turning out to be the case, and they are getting into a long-term stalemate themselves.
Thank you. My time has expired.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, gentlemen. And I repeat what so many have said here. Thank you for your public service. Given what you just said, General Clapper, about Russia being concerned about being bogged down, and going back to the comments of Senator Kaine about the cash reserves of Russia diminishing because of the price of oil, and you mentioned that at some point the street in Russia is going, these are my words, to erupt. Can you give us any sense of when that might occur, given these factors that has been discussed in the whole committee meeting?
Senator Nelson, I cannot. I don't know when that tipping point might occur. As I said, the Russian people have a great capacity for enduring discomfort and inconvenience and pain. But I think at some point they will reach a breaking point. And I think the Russian leadership is mindful of that and are very concerned about it. And so this sustained economic recession, which will go well into 2016, I think it's somewhat of an imponderable to try to predict when, if this is sustained, when that will cause a breaking point and when the street will say something.
From an intel standpoint, Putin can continue his diversions, Crimea, Syria, whatnot, to get the nationalistic fervor of the Russian people continually stoked up. But when they can't get butter and they get to the point that they realize that that's going more to guns, do we have any sense from the history of Russia of all, or from an intel standpoint, do we hear anything of the rumblings going on in Russia that would give us a better idea of how to predict that timing?
Well, no. I don't think predicting, sociological dynamics is very difficult when people will collectively reach a breaking point. That's, you know, kind of what happened with the demise of the Soviet Union, when the the big lie I think became evident to more and more people. That's another thing that the Russians worry about is information and information from the outside world. The Russians expend a lot of energy, time, and resource on controlling information and controlling the message in Russia. So the combination of these factors, their ability to endure the gradual erosion of the economy of Russia, their tight control of information, not unlike the heyday of the Soviet Union, makes it, to me at least, very difficult to predict when all those forces will collide.
Let me ask about assured access to space, which is essential to our national security. We have a great deal of optimism as a result of what we're seeing, a number of companies now producing rockets that seem to be quite successful. We have the likelihood of new engines being produced, but this senator is concerned, not in the long term, but more in the short term, of is there a gap there that if we do not have that Russian-supplied engine, the RD-180, that we will not have the assured access to space because of the alternative being, number one, that the Delta IV cannot be produced quickly enough, and number two, that it would be prohibitively expensive compared to the alternative of the Atlas V.
Well, as I said earlier, Senator Nelson, I'm in the customer mode. I have certain imperatives in terms of our assured access to space for overhead reconnaissance purposes. This is extremely crucial capability for the nation's safety and security. And so I look to the providers of those who get those things into space, which for me is the Air Force.
I understand
that. To decide that. So, the Delta has worked great for us. We felt it was responsive, it was cost effective,
right,
and it worked for us.
Are you concerned that there could be a gap?
Well, I certainly would be. I mean, when we've had to manage gaps, not so much from because of launch, but simply because of capabilities in space, that is a great concern to us and the intelligence community. So yes, I would be very concerned about gaps.
Senator Rounds.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Director Clapper and General Stewart, thank you both for your service to our country, and we most certainly appreciate participation that you have in this meeting today. In October of last year, the U.S. Naval Institute published a rather chilling article detailing the long list of advanced weaponry that the Chinese military has cloned by stealing from other nations, either through cyber espionage or reverse engineering. What roles do you see the intelligence agencies taking to prevent this hemorrhaging of American technological advantage?
Well, I think it's our responsibility to ensure that our policymakers, and particularly the Department of Defense, are aware of this hemorrhage, if you will, of technological information that the Chinese have purloined. So I think our duty, our obligation as from an intelligence community standpoint is to make sure people know about this, and where we can, suggest ways to try to stop it.
General Stewart?
I don't know if I could add anything more to that. We detect, we get an appreciation, understanding of the threat vectors, we inform, and if we can, we provide some potential solutions. Then it becomes up to those who have the technology, who have been threatened, their intellectual property threatened, to take those countermeasures. So I think we identify, we warn, we report, and it's over to the users.
Would you both, with regard to the tools that you have available today, do you have the appropriate equipment, tools, and technology to be able to detect and report these attacks?
Yes, we do, but I do think, and this gives me an opportunity for maybe a small commercial, that we do sustain our R&D. This is particularly important for, well, all the IC, but particularly NSA, that we stay ahead of cyber technological developments in the world domain for foreign intelligence purposes, to stay abreast of these.
What do you believe constitutes an act of war in cyberspace? What do you assess it would look like? When does it become an act of war?
That's a great question, Senator, that one that we've wrestled with. To a certain extent, it's I guess it's in the eye of the beholder. And this gets to the whole issue of cyber deterrence and all those kind of complex questions. But I think that's a determination that would almost have to be made on a case-by-case basis, depending on the impact.
So if we were to suggest that it was time to define what an act of war in cyberspace would be, it would not be appropriate? Or should we be looking at clearly defining what an act of war constitutes with regard to cyber activity? Would that be helpful? or not?
I think it would be extremely helpful to have clearer definitions of what constitute cyber events versus acts of war. We generally look at all cyber events and we define it as an attack. In many cases, you can do reconnaissance, you can do espionage, you can do theft in this domain we call cyberspace. But the reaction always is, whether it's an adversary doing reconnaissance, an adversary trying to conduct human operations in this domain, we define it as an attack, and I don't think that's terribly helpful. So if we can get a much fuller definition of the range of things that occur in cyberspace, and then start thinking about the threshold where an attack is catastrophic enough or destructive enough that we define that as an act of war, I think that would be extremely useful.
Have we done enough or a sufficient job in deterring cyber aggression?
I think we have a pretty robust capability to understand the adversaries. I think most potential adversaries understand that we have a capability. Whether or not we are ready to use that, because that's the essence of deterrence, that an adversary actually feels that we'll use the capability that we have. I'm not sure we're there yet, and that goes beyond our ability to understand and to counter with military capabilities. So I think there's another dimension of convincing from a policy standpoint that we're willing to use that capability.
Wouldn't it be a good idea to have a policy, General? As I understand it, we have no policy as to whether we should deter, whether we should respond, whether, if so, how. Wouldn't it be good if we had a policy?
Mr. Chairman, I always find it good to have a policy that guides the things that I can do as a military officer.
I think that's not an earth-shaking comment, to tell you the truth. I don't think we'll stop the presses. The fact is we don't have a policy, and I don't know how you act when there's no policy as to how we respond to threats or actual acts of penetration into some of our most sensitive information. Senator Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and welcome, gentlemen. Great to see two Marines at the table. As the chairman knows, the terms Marine and intelligence are considered synonymous by most, so glad to see you're
really
glad to see you're bolstering that fine tradition. I wanted to focus a little bit on the what's going on in the South China Sea. And Director Clapper, last time you were here, you expressed concerns over the possible militarization of some of the formations that are being built up in that part of the world by the Chinese. And as you know, here we are a year later, and that's exactly happened in terms of 3,200 acres of new land, seven large land features, an airfield, one of which is 10,000 feet long. What do you believe the Chinese, what do you believe their goals are in the region?
Well, I think the Chinese are very, very determined to sustain their exorbitant claims in the South China Sea. They've had this nine-dash line claim for some time. They have sustained that. I think they will continue with building up their capabilities on these outcroppings. And
do you think they're clearly looking to militarize those outcroppings?
Well, I think not sure what, you know, what the definition of militarize is. Apparently, President Xi may have a different view than different definition than we do. But I think when you put in runways and hangars and start installing radars, doing port calls with the Chinese Navy and Chinese Coast Guard ships. They have not yet, I don't believe, actually landed any military fighter aircraft yet, but they have tested the airworthiness, so to speak, of their air drones there with civilian aircraft. So,
I think
it's very clear that they will try to exert as much possessiveness, if you will, over this area and the South China Sea in general.
I want to follow up on a point the chairman just made. As far as our policy to counter that, you know, this committee, in a bipartisan way, has certainly been encouraging the White House, the military, to conduct regular FONOPs in the region, preferably with our allies. I think our allies are all very motivated to see American leadership here. Do you think that we have clearly articulated what our policy is, and do you think that regular FONOPs by U.S. military vehicles, ships, aircraft, with our allies, is an important way to counteract the strategy that seems to have very little pushback on it right now?
Well, again, this is policy, and we're just down the engine room shoveling intelligence coal, but I do think that we have made clear the policy on freedom of navigation and have done at least two FONUP missions.
Do you think our allies understand what our articulated policy in the region is?
I think they do, and I think they welcome our freedom of navigation operations. I think they are a bit reticent to speak publicly as supportively as they do in private.
Let me turn to the Arctic. I appreciated both of your focus on the Arctic in your testimony. And as you know, there's been a dramatic increase in the Russians' military buildup in the Arctic. There's been statements by the Deputy Prime Minister about how we should colonize the Arctic. You even mentioned, Director, in your testimony that the Russians would be prepared to act unilaterally to protect their interests in the Arctic. Let me just ask a couple of questions, and both of you can answer them to the, however you want in terms of prioritization. What do you believe the Russians are up to with their dramatic buildup in the Arctic? President Putin certainly is somebody who probes for weakness. How do you think he's reacting to our actual plans for dramatically withdrawing the only Arctic-trained forces in the active-duty U.S. military? And do we need to be looking at kind of FONOP kind of operations in the Arctic, particularly given that the Russians have such a significant interest in the Arctic? They've built up their northern fleet. They have 40 icebreakers. And the strategic Northwest Passage is only going to become more important. Is that something we should be looking at doing on a regular basis in terms of our FONOPs? You can answer any of those, all three of those questions if you'd like.
I can comment on, from an intelligence perspective, that we are turning attention to the Arctic. There's about a 6,000-kilometer-long coastline that the Russians have on the Arctic. They've established built around their northern fleet, a joint command to oversee their military activities. They're refurbishing bases there. They're quantitatively, they appear to have where they're going would be actually less than what they had in the Arctic regions during the heyday of the Cold War, but qualitatively it'll probably be better. What has stymied the Russians, as I alluded to earlier, though, was their grand plans for investing there, particularly with energy extraction, have been stymied because of the economic recession. So, and they need foreign investment from a technological standpoint, and they are not getting it because of the economic extremis they're in. So, yes, the Arctic is important. We engage with the countries that are a part of the Arctic Council, notably Canada and Norway. We're stepping up our intelligence sharing with those countries in terms of what the Russians are doing there. As far as what we do about it and troop deployments, that's kind of not our department.
But you can give us assessment on what you believe Putin would think as he builds up the Arctic, we're withdrawing forces from the Arctic. In your assessment of how he operates and thinks, what does he think about that? How will he view a reduction in Arctic forces by the United States when he is dramatically building up forces? You can certainly answer that question.
I don't know what he thinks. I don't read his mind, but I guess any time he sees an opportunity where he believes we're reducing or not being prevalent, then if that serves his purpose, he'll take advantage of it.
General, any views?
The Russians intend to increase their ability to control the Arctic regions. They've built air bases. They're building missile defense capability, both coastal and naval missile defense capability. They're doing that for economic and military reasons. In the absence of something that counters that, they will continue to expand. So there is, I think, an imperative that we have both the willingness and the capacity to push back on their control or dominance of the Arctic region. I think they're probably in a place where they they'd be willing to negotiate and discuss how you conduct operations in the Arctic, but they need to have something to push against.
Thank you. Thank
Senator,
you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator King feels compelled to ask an additional question.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, I think. quick question about money. Two questions, actually. Where does North Korea get its money? It doesn't seem to have much of an economy, and yet it's building missiles, nuclear capability, military buildup. Where's their funding?
Well, their primary trading partner, of course, is China, by far. Probably 90% of their trade. The biggest single export from North Korea to China is coal. Runs around, they get about $1.2 billion a year from coal sales. And then, of course, it's illicit finance. Illicit finances, they have an organized approach to laundering money and this sort of thing. So, but most of their trade in North Korea is natural resource heavy. And so the Chinese exploit that. So that's where they get the lion's share of the.
Is it safe to say that if China decided they didn't like the direction of North Korean policy, they could have a significant influence over it?
I don't think there's any question that to the extent that anyone has leverage over North Korea, it's China.
Second follow-up question, this time about Russia. What percentage of the Russian budget is funded by oil revenues?
Oh, I'll have to take that for the record, but a large part is a significant proportion of their budget is, I think, is from oil revenue. I don't know exactly what it is. I could.
And you talked about a 4% contraction, I believe, in their economy over the past year, which is projected to continue into this year.
Correct.
And at some point, it seems to me, they're going to reach a point where they just run out of money. And I wouldn't imagine they would be too good a credit on the world credit
right.
market.
They do have very significant reserves, financial reserves, that they've built up over years, which are starting to eat into. But you're quite right. I mean, over an extended period, they can't sustain that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very quickly, Director, General Kelly testified before this committee about this issue of this manufactured heroin, which has now become a major issue all over America, particularly the Northeast and the Midwest, this dramatic increase in heroin drug overdoses. Some of it comes across the land border. General Kelly testified before this committee that he, because of his lack of assets, he watches sometime seaborne transportation of drugs that land in various places in the Caribbean and come up into the United States. Isn't that an issue that you can trace to some degree to sequestration, but also the old squeezing the balloon theory?
Well, I can't say specifically whether this is attributable to sequestration or not. I just do know that there is a great deal of intelligence that the intelligence community produces on drug flow into the United States, and
some of that is shifted to seaborne.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. Seaborne interdiction with these semi-submersible vehicles that are sailed to the American coast. And the difficulty has been not enough operational resources, and particularly Coast Guard or Navy resources that could be used to take advantage of the intelligence that is produced. And I saw General Kelly speak to that just about every year he testified.
The interesting thing about this is that if you talk to literally any governor in the Northeast or Midwest of this country today, they would say that This is practically an epidemic and a dramatic increase in heroin drug overdose deaths. And now we're going to have this agreement with the FARC, which all of us want in Colombia. But does that mean that a lot of these FARC people will go into the drug business?
It certainly could, sir. And the other thing, I alluded briefly to this in my statement, was, of course, we're seeing an increase in cocaine, which is occasioned by, comes from Colombia. And as part of this agreement, and also, I think President Santos took heed of what were presented to him as environmental impacts of the eradication program that had been existent in Colombia for some years. And so they're stopping the drug eradication and trying to appeal to the farmers to grow other crops, which probably will be a challenge.
So we saw that experiment in Afghanistan, trying to get the farmers to go to other crops rather than poppies. In other words, it was a failure.
Well, it didn't seem to work, no. I mean, there is so much money to be made, and it's such a huge moneymaker that it's very hard, I think, to find other alternate crops that are legitimate, that are equally profitable.
Finally, I apologize for imposing on your time, but one thing we know is the Ergomesh, the company that sells the Russian rocket engines to the United States, is rife with people who are cronies of Vladimir Putin, people who have been sanctioned, part of criminal activities. Wouldn't it be better for us to, rather than giving tens of millions of dollars to Putin and his cronies, to buy more Deltas as part of the solution? And I know your answer is going to be you're the purchaser, but I also think that this almost borders on a national security issue, because if we're going to give tens of millions of dollars to people who are known thugs and Putin himself, who was just recently implicated by the British for the murder of a former KGB agent in London, the assassination of Boris Nemtsov in the shadow of the Kremlin, for us to unnecessarily provide the Russians with tens or hundreds of millions of dollars, it doesn't seem to me to be a logical way to do business, particularly if we have the opportunity to buy more Deltas and have the development of Russian rocket engines here in the United States, which people like SpaceX and others are working on. Do you have any comment?
I would agree with you. I'm interested in the service, in lift, in getting our reconnaissance satellites deployed on time. And I would much prefer that the totality of the system that gets those satellites into orbit were American.
I thank you. Senator Reid, do you?
I simply want to thank both General Stewart and General Clapper for their testimony to the service, and particularly, again, General Clapper, thank you for your extraordinary service to the nation.
Sometimes we have hearings that are maybe not too productive. I view this as one of the more helpful hearings that we have had before this committee, and I thank the witnesses for their candor and their wisdom. This hearing is adjourned.